Hello students, welcome to the class on economic survey. In this class I will be dealing with the fourth chapter of economic survey, and name of the chapter is the festering twin balance sheet problem. Now this chapter basically deals with the non-performing assets of the banks and the increasing problem of it, and how this problem needs to be resolved at the earliest, because this is a big problem and this problem can have very grave repercussions for Indian economy. Now, in order to completely understand this, what this entire problem is about, I have divided this chapter into three parts. In the first part of the chapter, I will be dealing with what is meant by this twin balance sheet problem and how this problem came into being. So basically in this I will be dealing with the theoretical aspect, because it is important to understand from theoretical perspective how this problem generally comes, why this disease of non-performing assets generally sticks to the banks, how it unfolds in the banks. And secondly, I will be dealing with the peculiarity of this twin balance sheet problem from Indian perspective. कि इंडिया में ये जो ट्विन बैलेंस शीट प्रॉब्लम है ये एक यूनिक प्रॉब्लम है. सो वी विल बी अंडरस्टैंडिंग व्हाई दिस इज यूनिक, व्हाई दिस इज पेक्यूलियर वन. एंड थर्डली वी विल बी अंडरस्टैंडिंग द सॉल्यूशन प्रपोज्ड बाय दिस ईयर्स इकोनॉमिक सर्वे, हाउ टू कम out of this problem. So let us start from this theoretical aspect. Economy meanders through the cycles of boom and gloom. Now what is meant by this boom and gloom? Boom means there are phases in the economy when the economy is very productive, economy generates higher growth rates, economy produces more, you can have more output and profits from the economy. Such phases of boom also forces or entices or motivates the corporate class to invest more. On the other hand side, we have the gloom phases. Now, gloom phases are the phases when the growth rate is less, when the productivity of the economy is less, when the mood to invest is less. And such a phase produces lesser growth rate in the economy. Now, from about 2000 till 2008, this was the golden phase of the global economy. Now, why the golden phase of the global economy? Because this phase has seen the higher growth rates. This was the phase when the canvas of corporate sector has increased tremendously. This was a phase when the forces of globalization and liberalization, they had exhibited themselves with the utmost force. Now, during this phase, governments have also played their important role by supporting these market forces. The governments around the world, they have played the role of an enabler. The keyword here is enabler. Governments, they have supported this entire private sector. Now, how the support was done to the private sector? Support was done, the governments were flexible in terms of their fiscal policies. Governments were also flexible by allowing the banks to offer loans at lesser interest rates, to provide credit to the corporate class at lesser interest rates. The banks, they had wanted to be party to this phase because they wanted to get more and more profits from this phase of productivity. Now, how the banks could gain out of this phase? The banks, by lending, they were hopeful that to whom they are lending the money, they will be returning the money with the interest, and this interest will add to the profits of the banks. So this was the vision of the banking sector. This is something that was believed that would be unfolding with respect to economy. Now, from 2000 till 2008, investment to GDP ratio has also begun to peak. Now, with respect to India, the investment to GDP ratio around 2000, it was just around 12%, and it had touched almost in the 30s, like 35, 36, 37% of GDP. So the levels of investment they had begin to grow very high. So the corporate class has borrowed a lot from the banks, be it the public bank sector banks or be it the private sector banks. But after 2008, we begin to see the downturn in the economy. From 2008, the economy began to perform very badly. The yields, so this was a boom phase. From 2008 till now, we are still in the gloom phase. Boom and gloom phase. So this gloom phase resulted in generating less profits. The demand of the goods increased. The demand of the capital goods decreased. Everything was on decline. Globalization was on decline. Investments were begin to decline. And this has affected the entire world. Though the effect of global economic crisis that unfolded after 2008, it was less on Indian economy, relatively less. But because Indian economy is integrated with the world economy, it had a kind of an indirect impact on the corporate class that was operating in India. Now the corporate class began to feel the pinch during this phase. It was not able to yield profit. It was not able to even earn that much amount of money by which it could pay back its interest obligations. So this was the scenario for the corporate class. So Indian banks, they begin to feel the pinch. They begin to feel the pinch because their economic strength was declining and their NPA ratio, non-performing assets ratio, it had jumped to about 12%. 12% ke kareeb non-performance assets ho gaye. Agar aapne 100 logon ko loan diya hai, usme 12 log aapka loan wapas nahi kar rahe hain. 12%. So this is actually a huge amount. And this amount was owned by the big corporations, big corporate houses. 40% were such companies who were not even able to pay back their interest obligations. They were not able to pay back their interest obligations. So this entire scenario resulted in creating twin balance sheet problem. Twin means the balance sheet of the banks also deteriorated along with the deterioration of the corporate houses. So the balance sheet of the banks as well as the corporate houses performed badly. So in such a scenario, which was hurting the Indian economy, but the effects of this entire phase was not felt completely on the Indian economy. Here I am just going towards the second phase, that is from Indian perspective. Generally what happens when NPAs of the banks rise, in that phase the growth rates of the countries generally dips down. Aisa hota hai ki jab interest rate aapka nahi ho pata hai, when the companies, they are not able to return interest, the banks strengths decline to support the economy. Banks are not able to support the economy and the economy takes a downturn. But as far as India is concerned, there were high NPAs to the tune of 10 to 12%, but the economy remained afloat. Though it was hurting economy indirectly, but economy was having the potential to sustain itself to the level of 7 to 8%. But generally this is not the case with the other economies. Like take the case of United States of America, the rise in the NPAs really hurted the economy, but the NPAs in the Indian case, they have not completely caused an injury to the Indian economy. There was no kind of direct or big relationship or substantive relationship, no directly proportional relationship like rising NPAs and economy falling. Aisa nahi hua, economy afloat raha. Now why this peculiar situation unfolded in India and why this situation was not same with that of United States of America? In United States of America, you have subprime mortgage crisis, SPMC crisis. In this crisis, the banks were defaulted by the people because they had borrowed loans for investment in houses and the reality market had crashed and the people were not able to pay back to the banks. And the banks defaulted, the banks were not able to support the economy. And the banks were not able to provide money to the corporate class. The entire circle of the economy got dissuaded, got stopped, got stumbled. But as far as the Indian case is concerned, Indian economy kept on moving. Now why Indian economy kept on moving? Very, very important to understand. Now for any developing country to develop and to unleash itself, it requires certain basic inputs. Inputs in the terms of infrastructure. Infrastructure like roads, like railways, like inland transportation, like island transportation. And then you require inputs in terms of power sector. Then you require inputs in terms of industrial bases, etc. Now from about 2000 till 2008, India has been able to provide all these things to India. India has been able to create all this for India. India has unleashed a lot of development in these inputs, and these inputs, they became the reason for the sustenance of growth, for the Indian growth. Chahe hamara NPS barkarar tha, despite the existence of higher NPAs, it was these fundamentals, strong fundamentals, that had helped the economy to kept on moving. Entire India was integrated because of the developed roads. Entire India was integrated because of the development of the power sector. Entire India was integrated because of the development of the industrial bases, etc. So all these things result in creating a distinct or a peculiar case whereby the NPAs, whereby the fragile banking system had not affected the Indian economy. Now, Indian economist, Indian economic policy for the banking had also believed that the support should be given to the corporate class. Because there was a belief system that the increase in the growth rate will support this corporate class, and this corporate class will be able to earn more profits, and this corporate class will be able to return back the loans. But the situation is very grave. 40% of the companies ICR, they have interest coverage ratio less than 1. I've already explained what is meant by this interest coverage ratio. By interest coverage ratio, you mean that the company 40%, we have such companies which are not even able to return or pay back their interest obligations. Forget about the base. Forget about the principal amount. And now this specter is not only has not only remained confined to the bigger companies, but it is also touching the smaller companies, small and medium companies. So small and medium companies, they are also getting influenced by this NPA thing, getting influenced by this thing that they are also not able to generate profits. So Indian economy is facing two challenges. The number one challenge is how to reinvigorate the banking structure, banking system, and how to reinvigorate, how to resuscitate the corporate balance sheets. So we have two challenges. Now these two challenges can be met if government will come out with rehabilitation packages. If government will support the banking system, if government will come out with such laws which can help the banks to resolve their credit issues with the companies. For this, government of India, it had come out with a policy in 2015. Now, this policy of debt restructuring had focused on the mechanism of resolution. Now, what is this mechanism of resolution? Now, mechanism of resolution means that the banks and the companies, the defaulting companies, they should come together, they should sit together, and they should decide about how the defaulting, how the NPA cases should be resolved. Agar aapne 1,000 crore rupaya lena kisi company se under debt restructuring mechanism, proposed debt restructuring mechanism of 2015, the company should settle it with its creditors. But this is not yielding any positive results, or this has not yielded any positive result. The reason being, after 2015, what we have seen is again a slowdown in the global economy. And another thing, that every company has different creditors from which it has borrowed the money. So it is not the single creditor from which it has borrowed the money. It has borrowed the money from multiple people. So all these banks from which it has borrowed, they must reach a consensus with the companies, with the corporate houses, of how much, for how much the default should be settled. And this is not easy, because the bank officials, they also fear of the corruption charges that might be leveled against them. Unko bahut dar hai कि उनके अगेंस्ट करप्शन चार्जेस हो जाएंगे अगर किसी को उन्होंने लोन माफ कर दिया तो. सो दिस इज ऑल्सो द रीजन वाई दिस प्रॉब्लम ऑफ एनपीएस इज सस्टेनिंग फॉर सो लॉन्ग. इट इज ऑलमोस्ट बीन अबाउट अ डेकेड, मे बी लेस देन डेकेड, बट इट इज टचिंग क्लोज टू अ डेकेड. So the suggestion of the last part of the lecture, solution part. Now this year's economics survey has suggested with coming out with para public asset rehabilitation agency. Now this agency should be set up and this agency should talk both with the banks and with the defaulting companies for how the things needs to be settled out. The government of India recently, it has come out with various laws with respect to defaulting of laws, but these laws, they have not yielded much. And as far as these laws are concerned, I have added a specific question with respect to this, what efforts has been taken recently by government of India in order to meet the challenges of twin balance sheet. So you must read those questions from the question answer booklet on economic survey. And I have also made the brainy map on this very chapter. So again, you can read it from brainyias.com. These chapters will be loaded by 15th of February. So you will get a booklet on this. So you can read that booklet in the question answer format. That will be in the question answer format. That will make it easy for you to learn about this. So the question that can be asked in your mains examination is about critically analyze the twin balance sheet problem. This is the one question that can be asked. The second question that can be asked could be like, how India should go about meeting this challenge of twin balance sheet problem? Or another question could be like, what is twin balance sheet program? So you must know in entirety about what efforts have been made, like Mission Indradhanush has been there. Then PJ Naik committee's recommendation was there, that how the restructuring should be done up. Then you should also study about the Bessel norms. So this was all for the day. Bye bye. Take care. Have a nice day.